As inflation eases, the Philippine government reaffirms its commitment to ensure affordable prices of commodities. The National Economic Development Authority says it will closely monitor the cost of rice and other goods. It also vows to continue imposing stopgap measures, including importing key commodities to cushion the effects of El Nino. The Philippine Central Bank also cautious about the impacts of the dry spell. The BSP hints at keeping monetary policy settings sufficiently tight until a sustained downward trend in inflation becomes evident. The latest inflation print dropping to its lowest rate since October 2020. The Consumer Price Index came in at 2.8% in January, hitting the lower end of the Philippine Central Bank's forecast. This also marks the second straight month inflation fell within government's 2-4% target range. The main drivers of deceleration were slower increases in prices of food and non-alcoholic beverages, as well as housing and power costs. Now, despite this, rice inflation in the first month of the year hit its highest since 2009 at 22.6%. An analyst expects the central bank to keep its policy rates tight despite easing inflation due to threats of the El Nino phenomenon.
It is well within the expectations. We do expect, however, that given some potential risks in the second quarter with El Nino drought potentially causing an uptick in food prices, that might cause some upward pressure in the inflation numbers seasonally for the second quarter. So while this is good and this is within the general range of the BSP target range of 2-4%, we also expect that the central bank will likely hold on to the rates for as of the moment, and any rate cut will likely happen towards the second half of 2024.
The Philippine government confident rice harvest will be stable this year despite the threat of the El Nino phenomenon. Jervis Manahan tells us why.
Agricultural damage from El Nino has breached 100 million pesos, according to the latest bulletin of the Department of Agriculture. But the agency is confident that there will still be stable rice harvest despite the threats of the weather phenomenon.
Kung ihimayin natin yung datos, yung total damage doon, maliit lang. Little over 100 hectares na naapektuhan talaga ng El Nino. Yung naapektuhan kasi ng El Nino talaga nauna yung western side. So posible na nalilate pa lang yung report ng Luzon area.
Officials went around some rice fields in Central Luzon and observed good standing crops, especially in Nueva Ecija, one of the country's largest rice granaries.
Nung binisita namin last week yung Nueva Ecija, yung ibang portions dyan sa may pabalik, maganda yung tayo ng mga palo. Maganda yung, kumbaga wala ako nakita kahit isang area na natuyuan at hindi nakatanim. So, meron pa nga ng mga late planters eh. So, ibig sabihin, meron ng iba-ibang level na meron malapit na mag-harvest, siguro by March, pwede na yun in the next 2 to 3 months. Meron naman na kakalipat tanim. So ibig sabihin, hindi nag-worry yung mga farmers natin.
In Pulilan, Bulacan, farmers still took their chances in planting rice. They were motivated by the good price of palay or unhusked rice last planting season and the promise of enough water supply.
Tinabi naman may patutubig kaya naglagay din kami. May kasi yung maghintay ka na naglagay kami asahan ka.
The National Irrigation Administration said it will be building more irrigation facilities.
Talagang nag-increase po yung ating budget. Seryoso po ang ating Pangulo dito po sa ating pagtataya ng mga bagong irrigation facilities. At the rate we're going, kayang-kaya po natin. Yung aming cropping calendar ngayon ay tinatama namin para ang NIA, yung aming mga irrigated land, ay makapagdalawang cropping man lamang kami sa panahon ng dry season.
NIA Chief Eduardo Guillen said he is hopeful rice self-sufficiency will be achieved by 2028. Ang GAT dam level is at 210.33 meters as of Monday, slightly lower than the normal high level. The Department of Agriculture gave the assurance that there will be enough water to irrigate farmlands. Jervis Manahan, ABS-CBN News.
The death toll from floods and landslides that hit the Davao region has risen to at least 21. Thousands more were forced out of their homes. Power also out in areas still submerged in floodwaters. In Davao del Norte, around 60,000 families have been affected. They are now appealing to the national government for more help.
Napadala po ng food packs yung DSWD as early as last month. Until ngayon, may mga food packs pa rin dumarating. More than 10,000 food packs na pong dumating sa distrito. At ang gawin ngayon ang pagbibigay ng mga food packs. Ang kailangan talaga ngayon, tubig, yung mga basic needs. Sabon, toothbrush, mga gamit ng bahay. Kasi most of them, sa bilis ng pagtaas ng tubig, hindi na nadala yung unabit-bit ng mga kailangan na gamit.
Experts clash as the Philippine Senate opened discussions on tweaking economic provisions in the Constitution. Let's hear more from Sherian Torres.
Framers of the 1987 Constitution and economic experts give contrasting views regarding resolution of both houses number 6, which proposes to relax the Constitution's national patrimony and economy, education, science and technology, arts, culture and sports, and general provisions. During Monday's hearing, former Chief Justice Hilario Davide warned members of the Senate Constitutional Amendments Committee discussing charter change would be very dangerous for the people.
Devils will have the day when angels fly away. That amendments to or revision of the Constitution at this time would be a lethal experiment. It would be a touch a dance to the grave or to hell. It would be a cruel punishment for a God-loving, patriotic, and nationalistic people. God forbid that we now amend our Constitution.
Davide's stand is in contrast to that of retired Justice Adolf Ascuna, who welcomes economic cha-cha. But should senators insist on doing the task via constituent assembly, Ascuna gave this reminder.
Economic policy should not be put in a constitution. What is the procedure to change, to amend? You have the CONAS. Says Congress, by a vote of 3/4 of all its members, may propose amendment or revision of the Constitution. You can call for a constitutional convention by a vote of 2/3, again, of Congress, we call a constitutional convention. Or to a people's initiative, which is much controverted right now, where you have signatures by the 12%. This is not what is sought to be done here. You don't have to meet jointly. There's no requirement for a joint hearing. There is no requirement for a joint voting either.
Retired Justice Vicente Mendoza asserts that although CONCOM delegates forgot to clarify the voting process in the Constitution, CONCOM records clearly state that Senate and the House of Representatives should vote separately on CHACHA.
Yung pag-uusap po ba sa pagitan ni Commissioner Suarez at ni Commissioner Regalado na kailangan joint session, voting separately, kapag ka ang napagkasundoan ay bicameral ay nasa record ng Constitutional Commission o pribadong pag-uusap po ba yan?
In the event that we adopt a bicameral Congress, we will insert the word joint assembly. The votes of the two houses counted separately.
Minutes before the discussion kicked off, Senator Robin Padilla filed resolution of both houses number 7, aiming to insert the words both houses in joint session assembled, voting separately in the Constitution Section 1 or amendments or revision provision. Lawyer Christian Monson meanwhile insists to the panel to touch on the anti-political dynasty provision of the charter.
I request the Senate to initiate the passing of an anti-dynasty law, which is long overdue by 36 years, and to amend the party list system that politicians abuse.
This early, some senators are questioning RBH 6.
Yung sinasabi nilang restrictive, restrictive, di umano. Hindi po yan totoo. Bukas na po ang ating tindahan. Kaya huwag sana nating gawing collateral damage ang konstitusyon.
I am also puzzled by the list that has been provided for public services given the many problems we have had with NGCP.
House Deputy Speaker David Suarez hopes Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri will keep his word for the upper chamber to approve RBH number 6 by the end of March. But panel chairman Senator Sani Angara is targeting an October deadline.
Sa akin naman ang pinaka-deadline yan is yung filing sa October. Kasi by then, siguro Comelec will need to finalize. Kasi kung ipasa namin ito, kailangan may plebisito tayo. Eh. So kailangan masama yun sa election. And yung most economical is masama siya sa 2025.
Sherian Torres, ABS-CBN News.
A Philippine lawmaker calls on the Senate not to invalidate the ongoing signature campaign for a people's initiative to amend the charter. Camarines Sur Representative El Rey Villafuerte says bribery allegations hounding the effort should be proven first. He adds the Senate should not be afraid to vote jointly on charter change.
Pag may allegation ba sa election na may vote buying, does it invalidate the whole election? If there are certain sectors or districts that, you know, allegedly committed bribery or use of government resources, that's wrong. We will not tolerate that. But it does not invalidate the whole signature campaign, the people's initiative. Ang fear ng mga senators, pag jointly raw, ay wala, outvoted sila. That's not true. They are national leaders, Karen. They are 24 senators. If one senator has 8 allies, that's 184 already plus 24, they have the majority. They have bailiwicks. Most senators have bailiwicks.
Villafuerte, meanwhile, thanks the Senate for finally tackling the economic provisions of the Constitution. He also hopes the chamber will stop its tirades against the lower house and its leadership.
Respect should be mutual. We're a co-equal branch. Dapat hindi kami tawagan or accused of things na niloko na ganyan. Mali po yun. Let's move forward. Let's talk about charter change. Let's help the country progress, move forward. All this talk about, disagreements should be done in a professional manner. No? Wag yung name calling. That's just my appeal. No?